have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city.
Shall I kill them? He answered, no. Did you capture with your sword and with your bow those whom you want to kill? Set food and water before them, so that they may eat and drink, and let them go to their master. So he prepared for them a great feast. After they ate and drank, he sent them on their way, and they went to their master. And the Armenians no longer came raiding into the land of Israel. And then if we skip to the New Testament, to Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20, Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20 says this. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and earth have been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." There's some pretty cool words in those two bits of scripture. But let's first look at that whole Kings passage. If you read the whole of 2 Kings 6, it's pretty much weird, if I'm honest. It's a strange world where boys are returned to life, where miraculous provisions take place, where military leaders get healed, where there's these strange acts of power, where nature just stops behaving the way that it should, gravity forgets what it should do, and axe heads float. It feels a very long way from the world that we live in. But when I think about it, it's not that far away from the accounts of Jesus in the Gospels. The accounts of Jesus are that he healed people, he raised people from the dead, he defies the laws of nature by walking on water, he calms storms with a word, he feeds 5,000 people with scraps of food. And in both parts of the Bible, in the Old and New Testament, God speaks to the powers of the day and he reminds them that they are not in control. That there are areas in life that is beyond their control. That God is God and he is in control. And it's a challenge for most of us because we see the world through this kind of normal lens. The lens that decides what can and can't happen. And so if we're honest, we can find ourselves a little bit closer to the servant of the man of God in the 2 Kings account, rather than the man of God, the prophet. The servant believes his eyes. The prophet sees beyond his eyes. The wider picture here is that God's been telling Elisha where the rival king armies are going to be. So Elisha goes and tells the king of Israel, and he explains this to him. So therefore the king of Israel was able to strengthen his armies in those parts of the territory. And so Elisha's role has become incredibly politically helpful to the king of Israel. And I love the servant in this story. I can imagine the servant in this story just thinks, you know what, I've got a cushy little job here. I'll just walk around with Elisha the prophet doing the work of God. It's going to be great. And all of a sudden, he finds himself running for the armies. He finds himself right in the middle of a political and civil war between two rival kings. Suddenly, he's not living the dream of ministry anymore. And so you can just feel it. I mean, he goes out one morning, he looks up, and he sees around the city horses and chariots, and they are after him and Elisha. And so this guy is terrified. And so the Bible puts it very calmly. He goes to Elisha and says, "Elisha, what shall we do?" I think that's a rather calm and polite way of putting it. And Elisha says to him, "Do not be afraid. For those who are with us are more than are with them." Elisha has God's perspective. And in that moment, any human being would have been completely freaked out. But Elisha has hope. And so prays. He prays that his servant will be able to see the situation from God's perspective. And there's this amazing moment in the scripture where Elisha prays and the servant's eyes are open. He's able to see what is really going on. Because in the natural, they were completely surrounded. They were outnumbered. But then there was this, but then in the supernatural, the hills were filled with angel armies, angels that the Lord had sent to protect them. And the servant's eyes were opened, and he was able to see all of that. And so the first reason we need to seek God's perspective on our front line is because God, when we get God's perspective, it dispels all our fears and it gives us hope. All of our lives contain moments where we feel surrounded on all sides. And in those moments, we have two choices. Either we can be like the servant and we can see the armies all around us and let fear rule our hearts. Or we can be like Elisha. We can look up and see what God is doing. We will always have that choice on our front line. And of course we see this, don't we, scattered throughout the whole of scriptures. I think the Psalms really do personify this perspective of looking up. We see so often, don't we, when we read the Psalms, David is just freaking out because all his enemies are coming to attack him. But he always remembers at the end of the Psalms, even if they go on a bit, that even in the craziest of moments, he has hope. He trusts. He rests in God's care. And you see, often in this scripture, the servant started out freaked out, and then he remembers to look up. Like Elijah, he knows he has hope again. And that's our choice today. Today in church, today in our front lines at home, with our families, in our workplaces. We have a choice about which perspective we're going to look at. When I used to do some youth work, before they realised I was going to get it in, they used to play a game with the young people called the ice cube game. It was a pretty simple game. You would give all the young people an ice cube and just get them to hold it and see who could hold it the longest. And of course, the wiser of the young people would realise this stings a bit. It hurts, but it will melt. It will go away. And that's a little bit like what happens with us in situations. We know we're in a difficult situation. We know it hurts. We know it's painful. We know it's painful. But if we just keep going, God's angel armies have got us covered. That difficult situation at work will pass. That financial problem will be overcome. That situation in your family that you just can't figure out will pass. Yes, it will, but it will pass. It's having God's perspective. That some youth would have that perspective that the pain would pass, that it would melt and they would win the chocolate bar. Others just when this hurts and gives up and chucks it on the floor because they had a different perspective. They didn't have a perspective that would endure. They didn't have a perspective that would last. And that's our challenge in our everyday life, to have the right perspective. Because Elisha looked up and gained God's perspective in that moment. And all that fear just dispelled. God's perspective blasts out those fears and gives us hope. The author J.K. Chesterton said this: fairy tales do not tell children that dragons exist. Children already know dragons exist. Fairy tales tell children that dragons can be killed. We don't need to read the Bible to know that there are situations and forces out there that make our life difficult. We read the Bible to know that those forces have already been defeated. When we see the world through God's perspective, our dragons get a whole lot smaller and we learn to hope. If we jump back into the account in 2 Kings, God's perspective changes everything. So the tables are suddenly turned. What happens is they go out, they see God's armies and Elisha. Christ. And this whole army has come to capture two people. Now, this is quite possibly, for the army, the easiest mission they've ever been sent on. They've just got to go and pick up a prophet and his servant. It's an easy day at the office. Two guys, I always think Elijah's a bit of an old man, there are two guys here, and they send a whole army that surrounds the city. This is a really easy job for them. But all of a sudden, they are struck blind. They're stumbling around in darkness. And when their eyesight is restored, they realise they're right in the heart of enemy territory. They're looking straight at the king who they've been trying to destroy. These guys have gone from having the most easiest day in the office to a nightmare day in the office. This is the worst day. They are looking at the king face to face. They are preparing to say their last prayers, to say goodbye to everyone, thinking that they are in for it. They are going to die. And then they hear Elisha's voice saying, no, let's not kill them. Let's give them a feast. Let's feed them. Let's throw them a party. I would have thought in that moment you were thinking you were going crazy yourself. But before you know it, you're being entertained by the king. The king that is previously your enemy is throwing you the best feast. This is a crazy day for the army. And so we're left with the question, why on earth, after capturing the whole army, instead of killing them, did they give them a feast? Why? I think it's because God's perspective shows us how to live. When we see God's perspective on situations, we're faced to make a choice that don't actually reflect our natural human choices in that moment. We make a choice that honours God. We make a choice that allows us to act more wisely than living out of our human perspective. You see, Elisha could have had all of those captures killed. But by offering them the feast, he shows them the grace of God. And in doing so, he instigates political peace and stability between these two rival kings. It's an absolutely genius move. The Bible tells us at the end of the passage that when the men returned, they tell their stories to the band around and they stop invading Israel's territory. This was such a bigger, wiser kingdom move from Elisha. Seeking God's perspective in that moment taught him that gentleness is stronger than force. God's perspective shows us how to live, and the Bible is filled with all this incredible wisdom and strategy about how we're to live our lives. The Bible isn't a manual or instruction which gives us a load of do's or don'ts. I hate it when people refer to the Bible as a manual in that way. The Bible is a book. Being Christians is not about what we do or what we don't do. Being Christians is about ultimately learning to understand what God wants and why he wants it. And the Bible is about us learning what God is like, how God sees the world. To see these moments of potential around us, to see the angel armies, and to view things with God's eyes. And when we do that, it's almost like we start to live in colour. We start to live with proper meaning. Because what we do is we see that every person we meet, every possibility, we see God's heart just bursting with love and grace in that situation. And when we live out of that perspective, we learn and grow to be more like Christ. It's like when the king turns to Elisha and says, shall we kill them? I almost think there's a pause before he answers and says, no, let's give them a feast. And in our everyday lives, there has to be that moment where we pause just to check God's perspective. And the more we know God, the more time we spend in prayer, the more time we spend in reading the scriptures, the more that will become instinctual. It becomes what we normally do to see what God is doing. We need to learn to look up And just as Elisha looked up and saw the angels of the armies, we see this parallel totally in the life of Jesus, who constantly said, I only do what I see my Father doing. And so there's this lesson, this spread out through the whole of Scriptures, encouraging us to look up to see what the Father's doing. And it's only as we spend time in prayer and worship in Scriptures that we get that. And we change our perspective of how things are. I mean, there's this great moment in the accounts of the Gospels when the disciples and Jesus are totally exhausted. They've been going out for days and days and days, and they just need to rest. And all the crowds have come to see Jesus, and the disciples are like, no, we need to stop. But Jesus looks up, he sees what his Father is doing, and he goes to the crowds. You see, viewing life from God's perspective was so natural for Jesus. But it was so also incredibly intentional, seeking the Father's will. Spending time, that's why Jesus went off the nights at times to pray and to fast and to seek God. So he could align his heart, his spirit with the Father. Because the Father calls us to live in an alternative world, to live in a world of faith. And the Matthew chapter 28 passage, go therefore and make disciples, that text is not just a rally call for the church to put its ideas into actions. It's a promise. It's a promise that the risen Lord will always be with us wherever we go, beyond the boundaries of our known worlds, beyond our comfortable relationships, beyond our workplace. God will always be with us. Following this God, seeking to only do what the Father is doing, is unsettling. God doesn't adapt his call to our expectations. He asks us to adapt to his. And I think what we need to do in journeying on in our fruitfulness in the front line is being intentional to seek after God's perspective so we can put all this stuff into action. I want to challenge you tomorrow when you walk into your workplace, into your classroom, into your family situations and where you live. When you walk into those rooms, I want you just to pause and ask the Father, God, what are you doing here? What are you doing in this situation? If Jesus was here this morning, who would he be sitting next to? Who would he be talking to? Who would he want to encourage? What does God really think about the people you sit next to in your workplace? The people you sit next to on the train? As our eyes get focused on God's hand at work, we will see where he is working and we will do what the Father is doing. I really want us to be a church that lives like this is real, that puts this into action, that sees God's perspectives, so we can really can face all those dragons with a certainty that they are already defeated, that we can walk into a room and know what God is doing, what his heart is for those people. And when we do that, we become fruitful, because we're able to do exactly what the Father is doing. And what's the Father doing? He's bringing freedom to the captive. He's releasing the poor. He's healing people. He's restoring lives and families. That's what God's doing. And you and I, our responsibility is to leave God's fingerprint wherever we go. So there is no doubt. There is an absolute certainty that the risen Lord Jesus is in every place and will never leave anyone. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your word, your spirit and truth. We thank you for the same spirit that was with Elisha and his servant. It was the same spirit that was with Jesus and his disciples. And it's the same spirit that is with us now. Holy Spirit, would you open our eyes that we may see what the Father is doing Father, forgive us when our selfishness, when our sin, when our own desires and comfort get in the way of seeing what you are doing. Help us truly to be disciples of Jesus that only go about doing the work of the Father. Equip and empower us as we leave this place to be fruitful ministers of your gospel, a gospel of grace and of peace, a gospel of power and transformation. We ask this in Jesus' name.